Michigan Out of Doors Online is brought to you in part by...
By Metalloid Firearms and Sports, utilizing botanical technologies to develop an advanced high-performance line of environmentally friendly firearm maintenance products that will not only clean and protect your firearms, but also your leather and wood components. Find out more at MetalloidFirearmsProducts.com.
And by Mr. Muskie Charters, offering full-service guided fishing trips for walleye, muskie, bass, and sturgeon on Lake St. Clair and the Detroit and St. Clair Rivers. Booking information is online at MrMuskieCharters.com.
Hey everyone, happy November and welcome to Michigan Out of Doors. I'm Jenny Olson and we've got a great show for you this week. We're going to meet up with a group of high school students who is working together with one of our auto manufacturers here in Michigan to increase the population of bobwhite quail in the southern part of the state. You won't want to miss that story, but before we get to that story, Jimmy and Jordan have some other fun in store for us.
Well, Jenny, I am kind of excited for your bobwhite quail story. And speaking of upland birds, we're actually going to kick off this week's show by doing a little grouse hunting in the northwest part of the Lower Peninsula. I was able to get out with some really good guys and some really good dogs. You won't want to miss that story. We're also going to head to the Upper Peninsula, do a little brook trout stacking on this week's program, and we're going to have some good shooting tips for you as we all get ready for the upcoming firearm deer season that's just a couple of weeks away. Lots of good stuff on this week's show. You stay tuned. I'm Jimmy Gretzinger. It's time for Michigan Out of Doors.
From the first spring rains to the soft summer breeze, dancing on the pine forest floor. The autumn colors catch your eyes, here come the crystal winter skies. It's Michigan, Michigan out of doors. Someday our children all will see this is their finest legacy, the wonder and the love of Michigan, as the wind comes whispering through the trees. The sweet smell of nature's in the air. From the Great Lakes to the quiet stream, shining like a sportsman's dream, it's the love of Michigan we all share.
Michigan Out of Doors is presented by...
By Country Smokehouse, offering a variety of meat products. Country Smokehouse is located 3 miles south of I-69 on M-53, just south of Imlay City. Country Smokehouse is a meat processor, a butcher, and a destination for sportsmen. By KL Outdoor, a Muskegon manufacturer of sportsmen's outdoor products for over 30 years, featuring the Terrain line of hard-sided hunting blinds designed for quick setup and removal with quiet operation. For more information and other products, kloutdoor.com.
By G5 Outdoors, makers of the Quest and Prime bows. Manufactured and designed in Memphis, Michigan, G5 offers archery bows, broadheads, and accessories. On the web at g5outdoors.com.
By Meyer, a destination for hunting, fishing, and camping supplies, offering hunting apparel and accessories, as well as hunting and fishing licenses. Meyer has nearly everything you need to take on nature and get you there.
This edge down, we're going to jump across some hardwoods. We're just going to stay on the edge right all the way back around. We'll come right back up the two track.
Okay.
So we find that birds orient to the edges and their escape habitat is off the edge. So we want to make sure that we are, if there's 15 birds in the cover and 12 live on the edge, that's where we want to be.
Okay.
And if we have the ability to cut off their escape routes, we win.
Perfect.
The Heller boys, Fritz and Rick, had invited me last year to tag along on a hunt. I couldn't make it work, so this year I wanted to hit the woods with these guys and their buddies, Brad Adamson and Eddie Beekman. These guys hunt a lot, they hunt hard, and they get a lot of birds. These guys hunt with flushing dogs, so getting the flush on tape can be a little tricky, but I was hoping for the best.
So, woodcock fly up to our left and got it one shot and a good retrieve by Bess.
Nice. Nice little timber doodle.
Absolutely.
All right, we got one on the board.
One on the board, one down.
Good shot.
Thank you.
I had Fritz walk me through the best parts of hunting with flushing dogs versus pointers.
The flushing dogs are always right with us. They're always in front of us. They're in the best habitat all the time. They're very obedient. They're excellent retrievers. Our dogs are very experienced in this grouse game. but we don't spend any time not in the best of the best habitat. Okay. And we take our chances as we go from there. The dogs, it's our job to take the dog to the birds, and then it's the dog's job to put the birds up in front of the gun to make sure we don't miss any birds, we don't walk by any birds. And then I think the birds react differently over flushing dogs. I think they tend to, they're more concerned with avoiding the dog than they are avoiding the hunter. When a hunter's walking in front of a point, that bird's now trying to elude the hunter. Mm. And I think at times it makes the birds fly higher and it makes the birds make more mistakes.
Okay.
So the advantage of a flushing dog being the bird's trying to avoid the dog, not the hunter.
Okay. And how close should a flushing dog work in cover like this?
Our dogs will work anywhere from 10 yards to 40 yards in front of us. We can stop them with a remote whistle command. Mm. If we see them get birdie and they're out of gun range, we can work up and get them. Other times we'll walk an edge and we'll have the dog in the cover 40, 50 yards from us, but they're in the cover in line with us. They're not necessarily in front of us. And we're taking our chances on them moving birds while we're standing or walking along the escape route.
This is thick cover, and usually, if you get to where you can barely swing your gun, well, that's where the birds are.
Good shot. Nice shot, young man. Let's see that bird for a sec. Yeah, dog got it right up.
Good retrieve.
Yeah, it was.
Finding the right kind of cover is key in having success in the upland woods.
Really with our flushing dogs is finding the spot within the spot. So when you've got this 40 acre cut, there's an objective in the middle that draws birds in. So that's our regular area that you want to focus on, and you want your dogs to learn how to hunt objectives. So you ask why we walk fast. We walk fast because we're searching to go from objective to objective throughout the cover. So the faster we can get from one objective to the next objective, the better chance we have of moving more gotcha. Birds and being able to put a pattern together that we can stay on okay. and find them throughout the day.
So just like fishing fast, you're covering more water.
Absolutely.
Okay.
More ground you cover, more birds you find, more birds you kill.
There we go.
We did move around a lot today, hitting several spots trying to find the birds. Now you may have noticed a few of the guys wearing GoPro cameras. Well, not long ago, these guys started the Grouse Commander website and YouTube page. You can find all sorts of cool videos and stuff on their page. It's really a cool way to showcase their hunts around Michigan and around the country as well. It's been a great way to let folks know more about this great sport.
Well, we were receiving a fair amount of attention through some articles that were written around the state. And after an RGS banquet, Eddie and Rick and Brad came and said that they had officially opened up Grouse Commander LLC in an effort to share our wisdom and our knowledge of the woods and increase hunter participation. We sell hats and t-shirts. All the proceeds go back to either veterans hunting or the Rough Grouse Society or other conservation efforts. We do our best to sponsor those items around the state, and it was a way to legalize it and have something to share to be able to spread the word. And you know, without grouse hunters, we don't have a need to manage forest. And so when you have when you don't have a user for a natural resource, we don't have a need to manage that natural resource. And so it's just our way of doing a small part, having some fun with it and spreading the word. The options were to kind of run and hide, or it was to use our knowledge and our passion to try and get other folks interested in the sport that means so much to us all.
And this is the block of autumn island. You with me?
We're with you.
Okay, yeah. So the plan is to get Rick probably going here. I'm gonna come here. I need a guy then to come here. You gotta make a decision whether you're gonna walk around that, you know, that left loop, or you're gonna walk here. And then I need a guy to come stand right there.
I'll take the stand spot.
I'll take
you better
Tango
get
up
going
now.
Okay. All right, you better get going then.
Which direction is the sun coming from?
The south.
That way. Okay.
Do you understand the plan?
Not a
And then Brad.
So you're going to be
Well, the plan may have been a little hard for some of the guys to follow, but it was working. Just my camera was never quite with the right shooter.
All right, let's see that bird. Oh, what a dandy.
Right down in the low stuff, eh?
Yeah, came right up off the edge of that swamp down there.
Nice.
Took me two shots, but we got it.
Nice job, good bird. What'd you find there?
Well, we found a nice mature bird coming out of that autumn olive thicket down there. It got up in some more mature stuff and gave me a great look coming across, so sometimes it feels a little easy.
The gray ghost. Nice job.
Thank you. Good boy, Jones.
Kill
it! Hey!
I was waiting, Eddie, you're giving me a heart attack.
Well, this is Brad's.
Oh!
Yeah, yeah.
I saw it in the air. I couldn't tell who was
shooting. That's a nice bird.
He gave you a little open shot here. But you never live
nice,
that one down.
Nice right to left, over the top.
I'll let Brad have it.
Good deal.
These guys were a lot of fun to hunt with. And this footage here on Fritz's gun showed you just how little time you have as a grouse hunter to make the shot. It can be hard and rather daunting for folks to ever catch their gun up to these fast-flying birds. But that's part of the challenge, and it makes success that much sweeter. If you'd like to know more about the grouse commanders, just Google them and check out their videos. It's a great way to get you excited for your next trip afield. And no matter how many birds you may put in the game bag, upland hunting is about as good as it gets here in Michigan's Out of Doors.
Hi, I'm Jordan Brown, and for our next segment on this week's show, we're going to switch gears and head way up north, all the way to the western end of the UP, where I was able to tag along with some folks from the DNR to learn a little more about stocking brook trout in that part of the state.
I've been on quite a few fish stocking trips over the years, but this one was a little unique, starting with a mile-long walk to reach our destination, Timber Lake.
Today we're here at Timber Lake in Iron County. It's in the western Upper Peninsula of Michigan. Every fall we plant brook trout, actually stock brook trout, into the area lakes. The brook trout that we're stocking today are about 5 inches long. They come from Marquette State Fish Hatchery. The brook trout provide a real high quality fishery when they grow up. This lake in particular has quality fishing regulations. It's a 15 inch minimum size limit, artificials only. It's about a mile walk into the lake itself. A lot of the other lakes in the area are stocked at the same time with these same type of brook trout. The regulations on those lakes might vary, so it's best to check the regulations for specific waters before you head out onto them. But each lake provides a different experience and a different opportunity for brook trout anglers.
Getting these brook trout into this particular lake isn't easy, but they've developed a system that works well, and the survival rate on these fish is actually pretty high.
The fish are loaded right at first light in the morning onto the truck. The truck comes to the area and meets us at the trailhead. While the truck's en route, I get the fork quad ready with a tank on it, and I usually check the trail. We'll use a chainsaw, cut my way into the lake. It's about a mile back from the trailhead to the lake in this case. Meantime, the truck arrives. We put the fish onto the quad. We've got oxygenated water on the quad, and then we bring them in. We bring about 1,000 fish at a time. This lake received 3,200 fish today. That's our normal plant. We've been stocking this lake for quite a number of years. The fish coming from Marquette Hatchery are really, really nice, high quality fish. We get real good survival with these fall fingerling fish. I'm from the area, so I've been fishing here for quite a long time, and there's a lot of memories that are created on these bodies of water. You know, they're good, really good quality fisheries.
Timber Lake is a great example of the benefits that come from a successful stocking program, creating an excellent fishery capable of producing trophy-sized brook trout.
This lake in particular is one of our higher quality lakes. It's a 70-acre lake. The brook trout range up to 20 inches in length. There are rumors of the fish that's over 20 inches. A lot of people come in here with float tubes, and they like to fly fish or use spinners. Different types of tackle are used. Some of our other lakes in the area, Killdeer Lake, for example, has got numbers of fish. It has easy access. you're allowed to use a more relaxed number of gear types, and fish in there up to 16 inches are caught on a regular basis. So these are part of our trout trails program, and they're listed in our brochure. We've got some high quality streams in the area as well, so it's great to come out here and give some of our lakes a try, try some of our streams, and there's a lot of diverse opportunity in the area for brook trout fishing.
There are several good fishing lakes located in this area, and a little research on accessibility and stocking can make for a very successful and enjoyable fishing trip. Special thanks to Mark for a very informative day on the water.
Well, hey, we are here just before the gun season here in the great state of Michigan. We're here with Bob Coletta, and Bob has been in the outdoor industry forever and really kind of knows his way around a gun and a gun range. We want to get some good tips on folks that are maybe sighting their gun for the first time. Maybe they got a new scope over the summer, and they're going to be setting it up for the deer season, whether that's a shotgun or a rifle. Bob, what are some good things? I thought you made a great point. Before you even start shooting down the range, what are some things we should think about when it comes to scope alignment and just rings and bases and all that kind of good stuff?
Right, Jimmy. One of the things that people have to remember is that the rings and bases is what marry your optic to your rifle. And if that is not done properly, you're going to have nothing but frustration and problems when you go to the range and and try to zero your rifle. So the goal here is to give people a few tips where we're not spending tons of money on ammo because we can't get our rifle zeroed. So really it's important for the user to take time to make sure that they've A, got the proper rings and bases and a good quality set. I recommend something more like a steel ring and base versus an aluminum. When you're mounting the scope, you want to have the ultimate goal is to have things aligned perfectly so your crosshairs are in alignment with your barrel. And there's all kinds of different tips when you're, you know, when some people lap their rings, for example, it's a good idea to take a little rubbing alcohol and put it on the threads of the screws on your rings to get the grease off there, and even put a little, maybe a less aggressive Loctite. So once you have everything in place, it's going to stay that way.
Okay.
And when you're mounting, to also torque your screws equally, so you're not binding the scope in the rings. You're kind of locking things down on equal tension.
So when you put them in there, is there any method to the madness on eye relief or anything like that?
Right. So what I would do is when you put the scope in and you first get your rings kind of in place but not tight, is that's when you want to get behind your firearm and make the adjustment for your vertical alignment of your crosshair. You want it to be perfectly at 90 degrees, and also take the time then to set your eye relief. So the good way to do that is to close your eyes and then open your eyes, and it should be you know, a full field of view. You don't want to see that black circle around the edge of your scope. You can make an adjustment again, shoulder your rifle like you normally would, close your eyes, open your eyes. When you open it, you should have that nice big field of view.
Okay. And so just to make sure that you're not cranking your scope way over, when you put it on there and you look down through the bore, should they to kind of bore sight your gun, should it be somewhere on the paper? Should you, I mean, how does that work?
Right. That's the way I do it every time. If you've got a bolt gun, you can save a lot of time and money on ammunition trying to get your rifle on paper. So if your scope's brand new, it should already be set at factory zero. In other words, your windage and elevation, your crosshairs would be center in the tube of the rifle scope.
Okay.
If you've got a used rifle scope or something you're not sure of, the easiest way to do that is to count the maximum number of clicks from one extreme to the other. So let's just say, for argument's sake, it's 200 clicks. You'd come back 100. So now your windage and vertical are both set at factory center. So you have a crosshair that's centered in the tube, and if you've done your job properly with your rings and bases where everything's aligned properly, now your crosshairs are aligned with your barrel. So the best thing to do is when you get to your range is to pull your bolt, put it in a sandbag where nothing's going to move, and look down your bore and center your bullseye at 25 yards, right in the middle of your barrel.
Okay.
So when you take your eye right behind your barrel and then come up slowly, your crosshair should at least be on paper at 25 yards. If it's not, because at that point you've got a crosshair that's centered in the rifle scope, and you've got the barrel, and they should be aligned. If that crosshair is not at least on paper at 25 yards, then you know for sure you've got an alignment problem with your rings and bases.
And so if that's the case, would you, if they're not aligned, would you start messing with this right away if you know you're...
No, I'd stop and go back to the drawing board and go back to the rings and bases and see what's going on, because you're probably going to run out of windage and elevation or get frustrated and shoot through a lot of ammo first.
Okay. Well, stay tuned for next week. We'll have some more good shooting tips for you as we all get ready for the firearm opener.
In this next story, we're going to head down to the southern part of the Lower Peninsula to visit the town of Dundee, and there are two groups working together there to increase the bobwhite quail population in the area. It's an amazing project.
Last month here in Dundee, a great partnership came together to increase bobwhite quail populations in the area. Fiat Chrysler's Dundee Engine Plant, along with Dundee High School's FFA chapter, worked on this amazing project together.
Last year in an ecosystems class, one of my four classes, we were going over the animal life and plant life of Michigan, and we went through some of the animals and plants of Michigan, and no one had ever seen a bobwhite quail. I mean, they've seen bald eagles, which used to be none. We see wild turkeys, which used to be none, but none of them had seen a bobwhite quail. And so that was kind of a little seed in their brain. And then we started researching what habitat they like, what's ideal livability conditions, and all of a sudden the light bulb goes on that just north of the school is the Chrysler Engine Plant, and there is wonderful habitat for quail.
The habitat here is no accident. In 2006, the Dundee Engine Plant moved onto the land here and planted 132 acres of authentic Michigan prairie grass.
So approximately 10 years ago when the company founded this, which was originally GEMA, the Global Engine Manufacturing Alliance, but they had the foresight to work with a chosen university at the time, Michigan State. We have a beautiful grounds here. This was actually a farm that Chrysler bought with the Alliance at the time. So rather than plant grass, and you know, they had the foresight to envision the prairie grass. Obviously when it was first founded, planted, it was just, you know, fields. But now 10 years later, this has grown into beautiful prairie grass, and naturally we have fox out here. We see deer all the time. We have a lot of pheasant. The pheasant just love it here. I see them coming in the morning and when I leave at night. So we've just got this beautiful environmental sanctuary, quite frankly, for wildlife on our facility. We've got a lot of acreage here that, you know, has been turned into prairie grass. So we've got flowers, we've got lots of pollination, bees, all kinds of great things going on.
The engine plant and its staff are excited to work with the high school on this project, which involves lots of time, hard work, and money.
Well, I didn't imagine that the cooperation would be at the size that it is. I mean, they were eager to have a project. So then we recontact Chrysler saying, hey, you remember that offer? And now we have the quail project. We finally got it started with the baby quail in June, and then they grew over the summer. They've been in flight pen for like the last 6 weeks, getting their native skills, their natural skills down, and I think they look excellent today for release.
The plant and FFA chapter will let the quail adjust to native seeds and insects on the property for 2 to 4 weeks. Then volunteers from the plant will install feeders to supplement their diet.
They've got this great initiative where they've been raising the quail in captivity, and partnering with them, they've actually searched the whole region and found that our property is about as best as they're going to come up with in this area to really release these quail. So it's just a great win-win for the company, for FCA, for our plant, for Dundee. We're very proud of our environmental sustainability projects. This is actually a world-class manufacturing project that we're doing part of WCM in our environmental pillar in partnership with the high school. So it's great for the community, great for the high school, for our plant, for Chrysler. It's just a win-win all the way around.
The number of bobwhite quail has seen a sharp decline since the 1970s here in Michigan, most likely due to habitat loss and changes in agriculture. This 4-year project will hopefully help to turn that trend around. Once the supplemental feeders are installed, both the Dundee High FFA chapter and employees at the Dundee Engine Plant will monitor and support the quail project. It's great to see industry and education coming together to make a positive impact on our wildlife here in Michigan's Out of Doors.
Thanks for joining us this week for Michigan Out of Doors. Make sure you check us out online next time you get a chance. You can do it a couple of different ways on our website at MichiganOutofDoorsTV.com or on our Facebook page at Michigan Out of Doors TV. We're on Facebook every few days letting you know where we are and where we're headed next. And speaking of where we're headed next, we have a lot of fun in store for you here this fall on the TV show.
Well, make sure you are joining us over the next couple of weeks as we get ready for the firearm deer season here in the state of Michigan. What a great time of the year to be a sportsman. On next week's program, we're going to take a look at the archery season, see what Gabe and Jordan have been up to, see how they've fared in the archery woods. We're also going to have some more shooting tips for you, as well as a few other things. So lots happening right now in the state of Michigan. Make sure you are getting out and enjoying it. If we don't see you in the woods or on the water, hopefully we'll see you right back here next week on your PBS station.
Michigan Out of Doors is presented by Shows Fan, producing consumer shows including the Ultimate Fishing Show Detroit, January 12th through 15th at Novi's Suburban Collection Showplace. The show features fishing tackle, trips, boats, and seminars on all Michigan game fish. The Ultimate Fishing Show, Novi, January 12th through 15th. By Jay's Sporting Goods, with locations in Clare and Gaylord. Jay's, serving the Michigan outdoor enthusiast since 1971 with a wide variety of outdoor products. The gear, the knowledge, the tradition of Jays, on the web at jayssportinggoods.com. By the Michigan chapters of Safari Club International. For over 40 years, SCI has been protecting hunters' rights and promoting wildlife conservation here in Michigan and around the world. SCI chapter locations can be found on the web at firstformichigan.org. By Greenstone Farm Credit Services, making recreational land ownership possible across Michigan and northeast Wisconsin. Begin your land financing journey at one of Greenstone's 37 locations or visit greenstonefcs.com. Closed captioning is provided by Marvo Mineral, makers of Lucky Buck, deer management products including minerals to supplement deer diets year-round to improve health and antler growth.
When I want to far away, a dream stays with me night and day. It's the road that leads to my home state. I am a Michigan man. Changing seasons paint the scene like rainbow trout in a hidden stream, the white-tailed deer in the tall pine trees. I am a Michigan man.